How much is your life really costing you? Shocking stats on today's show.
It's Brian Preston, the money guy.
Yeah, Brian, this one I'm really excited about because you said this a little bit in pre-show prep, right? Everything that we're going to cover today, we've covered previously in different shows or different topics, but we've never actually put it all together to see what the real tangible impact is of the decisions that we make that seemingly are just decisions for today, but really are decisions far out into the future.
Well, I think this got me so excited because here's what we do to get you motivated. Because I've often shared my high school story of the my economics teacher, who's also the wrestling coach, who told me $100 a month would turn me into a millionaire. Yep. So we all the time cover the motivational aspect of the opportunity of putting your army of dollar bills to work. And I think it's worth repeating just for, in case this is your first show, this is the first time you've ever been to see a Money Guy experience. This is something we talk about a lot with the power of your army of dollar bills, is that $1 has the opportunity for a 20-year-old to become $88.
That's exactly right. If you haven't had a chance to go out to our website, you can go to moneyguy.com/resource page. We have right here on the screen, it shows what does $1 turn into for a 20-year-old or a 25-year-old or 30-year-old, but maybe you're 33 or you're 26 mm-hmm. or you're 42 and you want to know exactly what $1 will turn into you, go out to the moneyguy.com/resource page. We have this deliverable that you can download for free and see exactly how powerful every dollar you put to work right now at your current age can be.
But these things are related, but it's a different side of the discussion, is because that's the opportunity of what every dollar can yep. become at retirement. So that way you'll think differently about how you're looking at your money. So that then leads to the transition point of what's the opportunity cost?
That's right.
Because here's the reality of the situation. Small decisions lead to big impacts. So then if you think about, what is lifestyle creep? What is keeping up with the Joneses? Mm-hmm. What are all these things as we go through life? How does this all impact your future self and how much you have the opportunity to build in financial independence? So that's what today's show is going to cover. Not the opportunity, but what the opportunity cost is for all these major life decisions.
And we're going to kind of go through four common choices or four common decisions that most people make. Most people throughout the course of their life are faced with one of these four decisions. And what I think is so wonderful is every one of them seems so easy when you're making the decision right now. Okay, should I do A or should I do B? Oh, well, they're not that much different. What we're hoping that you gather from today's show is the difference in those decisions is massive.
Yeah, and this also ties into financial mutants. We talk about this concept of being a financial mutant mm-hmm. all the time because, look, I'm counting on anybody who becomes part of the Money Guy family. And by the way, what I mean by becoming part of the Money Guy family, I mean subscribing mm-hmm. to the YouTube channel, ringing the notification button, subscribing through Stitcher, however else you're listening to this, through Spotify. I just want you to be part of it. But here's what I think is interesting. If you're a financial mutant, your money should go 5, 10, 15% further than your peers.
Yep.
So pay attention to these type of lifestyle decisions, and you're going to see you will start bearing the fruit of making those financial mutant type decisions.
Love it. So I think, Brian, we're going to start small and try to get big. Yeah. Right? That's what we're going to do here. So let's talk about...
It sounds like a workout.
I love it, that we're going to warm up. Let's get warmed up with one of the decisions that a lot of folks fall into. And if you watch any sort of personal finance information, this thing always comes up. No matter who you're talking about, this spending behavior, this consumption behavior is always something that kind of rises to the surface. And we're talking about credit cards. What is the price of credit card debt?
Yeah, credit cards, we tell you all the time, debt is a four-letter word,
yep.
especially credit card debt, because this is one of those things, a lot of people are like, does this mean you're just all against credit cards? No, we're not against credit card use.
That's right.
We are completely against credit card debt. Yep. And that's because this thing we talk about all the time, compounding interest, deferred gratification. And compounding interest is going to be the thing where you take just a little bit today for that great, big, beautiful tomorrow. Mm-hmm. The way you can turn $1 into $88 is compounding interest. When you use credit cards, they take interest rates that you should be earning for yourself and they turn it on its head and actually bring it against you. So you're turning compounding interest to start being a force that works against you, and that is not a healthy behavior.
So we thought one of the things that might be valuable to walk through is sort of a case study, right? So let's look at the dark side of compounding interest. Let's just take a young person, 22 years old, that has an average credit card balance, and they're going to make the minimum monthly payment. So right now, the average consumer credit card balance is somewhere around 17.8%. Well, the way that most credit cards are structured, if you want to make the minimum payment, it's either $25 per payment cycle or 3% of the outstanding balance. You got to pay one of those two. Well, if you just look at the average credit card balance across credit card debt carriers right now, it's a little under $6,200.
Yeah.
So if you had $6,200 of credit card debt and you chose to just make the minimum payment, well, what's going to happen is you're actually going to pay $5,543 in interest, and it's going to take you almost 15 years to pay off that $6,200 of credit card debt. So that $6,200 is actually going to cost you almost $12,000.
This is the epitome of fake it until you make it.
Yep.
And I think that is what that is the siren song of credit cards, Bo, is that when you're young, you're broke. We're all broke.
Yep.
It's just how much are you faking it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so a lot of people, you're broke, and you hear this siren song of, hey, it's okay. You deserve it. Mm-hmm. You know, reward yourself. Go ahead. And you use that debt, that credit card debt, as a bridge
yep.
to carry you until your income reaches the point that you can truly afford it. The problem is, that is quicksand
mm-hmm.
because what seems like a viable strategy to fake it until you make it, you go find, guys, it's called a siren song mm-hmm. on purpose. It's just like you see all those horror movies where the beautiful mermaid turns into this serpent that pulls you deep into the water and gets you in trouble. That's why we talk about zombie debt.
Yep.
We talk about all the things, but this is the big takeaway. This is close to $12,000.
Mm-hmm.
You're like, okay, so I know if I'm buying $6,000 worth of goods, it's really costing me 12. That's steep, but over 15 years, that's just
doesn't sound like
I'm
that
paying.
Big of a deal,
I'm
right?
paying. You know, I'm just paying double what something actually costs.
Sure.
Maybe that's okay because my income's going up. But there's another side of this, guys. The opportunity cost. Because what if that money could have been working for you? What if you could have been investing in yourself and in your future? What is that great, big, beautiful tomorrow that you forfeited look like, Bo?
So let's look at that. What if that minimum monthly payment, either that $25, that 3% that you were paying, was invested instead of paying off credit card debt? Well, what you can see is after that 14.9-year period, after that almost 15 years, you will have almost $35,000 saved for retirement. Remember, you only put in the $11,000, right? That minimum payment that you were paying in, almost $12,000, but it will have turned into $35,000.
So that close to $12,000 turns to close to $35,000 by the time the 14 to 15 year period is over.
Yep.
But that's only part of the story, because we know that probably the addiction that nobody talks about because you become an empire builder is the addiction to saving
yep.
for the future. That $35,000 probably not getting pulled out just because you're in your mid-30s
mm-hmm.
and you're the debt's paid off. What actually does that turn into by the time you hit retirement?
So if we let that $35,000 keep working for you, and we're going to assume this is someone in their 20s, so they're going to make 10% per year, by age 65, you will have $573,000 saved for retirement. Remember, all that you put in was a little under $12,000. And it's turned into almost $574,000.
Okay, so that's warming up the plate for
uh-huh.
knowing how big your decision-making, because I like that we're starting from small to big, and the fact that this is what happens to young people is, like I said, you're bridging, you're faking it until you make it, you're keeping up with the Joneses, but that decision to take $6,000 from today, which turns into $12,000 of debt repayment, is actually close to $600,000 from your retirement. That's pretty powerful
it's huge,
stuff.
Huge.
So let's go ahead. I want to keep going down this discussion point, because here's the next one. Here's the financial napalm discussion that everybody has, because we all want to have a whip that looks good when you're young. Because it's the reality. Is it you've been in college, maybe you come from like we did, where my wife on our first date, she asked, it was kind of a setup date, and she asked her girlfriend, what color is his car?
Wait, what color was that car, Brian?
She said, well, It's kind of rusty because it literally was rusting away. I mean, I had what we called the Ragalier. It was a Chevy Cavalier that was so old, but it was one of those things. So I daydreamed about the day I graduated from college, got my first job. Mm-hmm. I couldn't wait to get the first car.
Yep.
And I'm telling you, this is the way everybody's wired. Yep. I need to reward myself for the great decisions that I've made by studying, being a good student. Mm-hmm. I deserve this.
Yep.
But guys, it has a cost, a huge cost, because what's the problem with cars? Bo, when you buy a car, what happens when you drive it off the parking lot?
It immediately loses value.
It doesn't matter if it's a new car, used car. They're constantly, these things are sinking in value every day.
Yep.
I mean, there's very few exceptions. You know, we could go back to the classic Mustangs, Camaros, Corvettes, but that's not what we're buying when we're 22 and 23 years old. We're buying usually the new used car, meaning new to us, or about a brand new car. So what's the financial impact of that?
So let's talk about how much does it really cost. So if you've been listening to us for any period of time, you know that we think that there's a correct way that you ought to go about making your auto purchase. And we think you ought to follow 23-8.
23-8. I like the sound of that. But walk them through what 23-8 means.
Quite simply, that means that when you buy a car, whether it's new or used, you're going to put 20% down. You are only going to finance it for 3 years or 36 months, and you're not going to let your payments exceed more than 8% of your monthly gross income. 23. Now, this only applies to regular brands. This is Toyotas and Hondas and fill in the blank. If you're someone who wants to buy a luxury car, 23-8 does not apply. In our opinion, if you want to buy a luxury car, you got to pay it off in 12 months. That's your time frame.
So if you're rewarding yourself with a BMW, Mercedes, Tesla, that's probably it needs to be paid almost like cash.
Yep.
But here's what I know from life, Bo. 23-8, that sounds great. But when you walk into the dealership or you do your first call for a purchase, they're going to say, what can you afford monthly? What's your monthly payment?
That's always the question that they ask.
We can get you in. You know, why focus? Why do you want to have that car paid off in 3 years? Maybe instead of paying the car off in 3 years, let's focus on what your monthly payment is. Hey, and we have great banking relationships. We can actually finance this car for 7 years. So that way you can get into something just a little bit more comfortable, something that's a little safer, maybe has more technology in it. This is what we can do for you is we can spread your payments, not 3 years. We can do 7 years. You ought to take advantage of this. This is a great opportunity for you. So that's how it's pitched.
That's exactly right. Hey, I love your 20 and I love your 8, but let's do the 7. Instead of doing 23-8, if you can afford that monthly payment, that 8% of your gross income, let's just stretch it over 7 years. And what you're going to be amazed by is that if you did that old money guy thing and you just did that 23-8, you could buy an $18,000 car.
And it's not lost on me that full-time equivalent Daniel, it's not a jalopy, but it's definitely not a sexy car. Kind of rolled in slowly. So you could actually qualify to buy a car that's around $18,000.
That's exactly right.
But when you go, you got the slickster salesman. He's like, don't focus on what the debt is. We're not worried about the debt. We're worried about the payments. Payments is what you need to focus on. So they're going to get you to finance same payment, but over 7 years. What does that get you?
Well, then, if you're willing to do that,
whoa,
we can get you into a $40,000 car.
That's sexy.
That is sexy. And the beautiful part about this is they're both the exact same payment, $421 a month. You, car buyer, make the choice. Do you want the money guy jalopy or do you want the fast, sexy sports car?
So do y'all see how we've set this up to where, I mean, it really is. The monthly outflow is exactly the same. The difference is how long are you willing to pay? And even I think that I love what Daniel did on the pictures is because it is true. A $40,000 car looks so much cooler to your friends and family than that $18,000 car. Even on our slide, it looks a lot cooler. But guys, there's a cost, huge opportunity cost. This is why I call this financial napalm, especially for young people, making these lifestyle decisions that really are the faking it until you make it. So let's kind of go ahead and walk them through. What does this do to your financial life in the long term?
And look, we want you guys to recognize we're not trying to like paint the numbers here, because we all know when we buy more expensive cars, the maintenance is higher, maybe the gas price is higher, the insurance higher. We're not even factoring any of that in. We're only just factoring in how much you have to pay off the car. So our numbers are conservative. I just want to lay that out there because I think it's an important distinction to make. So both cars cost $421 a month, but the affordable car will be paid off 4 years earlier.
Mm-hmm.
So what if over that 4 years, instead of having to pay for the more expensive car, you just invested that $421 per month? Well, what happens is after that 4 year time period, you will have saved just over $20,000. So if this is a 30-year-old from 30 to 34, you will have saved just over $20,000. But if you let that savings continue to grow for you, now we're at 9% because we're in our 30s, by the age of 65, that $421 a month over 4 years will have turned into almost $400,000.
And by the way, we only did this for 4 years of opportunity costs. We know that's not the way it happens because we do this once with a car. Because here's what Daniel found out last time we did a full auto show. I was shocked to see how much the average American is financing toward cars.
Yep.
Daniel found out that close to $2,000 of that amount was actually negative equity, meaning that they owed more than the car was actually worth. No problem, because the auto industry has figured out a solution. They'll just roll it into the next loan. So once again, we're turning compounding interest upside down, so it's working against you. You never actually own anything in your life. You're just financing it out longer and longer. So this is going to be a bigger than a four-year impact. This probably, this $400,000 impact is happening over and over and over again. So I'm thinking, once again, you said we're using very conservative assumptions, not taking into account the premium gas, not taking into account the maintenance and the insurance on the much more expensive cars. I think we're being conservative because we're making this mistake over and over again. The average American is not doing this right. Don't fall prey. Pay attention that cars are not investments. They are definitely expensive purchases that can derail your long-term financial life.
Now, I just think this is one just behavioral thing that I'll add in here. One of the things you've talked about all the time, Brian, is when you were young in your 20s, you didn't go out and buy a fancy car. You didn't go buy the new latest and greatest car. Instead, you made the choice to defer that gratification until some point later in life. Now, hey, do you? Because I don't think you'll mind sharing this. Do you care if you tell everybody what kind of car you drive? Is that okay?
Because
I don't know if our audience
now or
knows.
When I was 22.
No, right now, like the
well,
car.
I have a Tesla.
Oh, you drive a Tesla, right? I don't know if we all knew that.
Are you about to pick on me? This was not in the pre-show meeting.
How much more enjoyable is it now that you made that purchase decision at a stage in life when it wasn't something that had you eating, you know, cat food hamburgers every night for dinner? You did it when you could actually afford it. It made the joy of owning that thing a lot sweeter than if you were trying to stretch to get by early on.
Well, no, we talk about hedonic treadmill all the time. That's why I always get nervous. If you buy your kids too fancy of a car just because you can, and where's the celebration for themselves later? I mean, I like that I had a junky car all through high school, all through college, because when I bought that first Mazda, a used Mazda, thought it was the greatest car. It had the oscillating, it was a 626, had the oscillating vents on it. Brilliant. Didn't have leather, didn't have anything else, but it was great.
But and the then vents oscillated.
Yeah, but I mean, but that, think about all the journeys, because I haven't had a ton of cars. Yeah. I went from the Mazda to an Acura, and then I bought the Lexus ES350 that my daughter still drives, by the way, because I've passed it down before I got the Tesla. Is that all those things kind of rolled in to where I did have a sense of fulfillment when I did it in the right order.
That's
and that's why we talk about respect the food, the financial order of operations. And this whole thing we're talking about with the opportunity costs of your decisions really does have a big impact. And that's all right. Let's talk about the biggest one. Well, next to biggest one, because we have one even coming up. But this is one that's your shelter.
I think for most people, your house, your primary residence is probably the single largest purchase you'll make in your whole life. It's the most expensive thing that we buy, right? I mean, for most folks, that holds true.
And I feel like there's a general rule out there that, you know, you hear about when you're trying to figure out how much can you afford. We talk about 25% of income, but you also, if you're looking for benchmarks, three times your income.
Sure.
However, I have a feeling, because if you ask a mortgage broker, how much can I afford? Or you ask your real estate agent, they're not going to tell you three times your income. I bet that number is going to creep up a good bit further. So, Bo, kind of we have the resources where we can actually do research. What did we find out on what the typical American's doing?
So, yeah, so we know that right now the median household income in this country is a little over $63,000. So you would think, all right, if the median household income is $63,000, I should just multiply that times three, so the median home price ought to be about $190,000. Well, what we found is that the median home price
imagine that.
Is actually almost $318,000. So if you just take $318,000 divided by $63,000, the median new home is five times the average median income. That means most Americans, instead of buying a house that is three times their annual income, they're buying one that is five times their annual income.
So I can already hear it. Everybody who's out there listening in New York, California, or just high cost of living areas is going, oh my goodness, I wish I could buy a house for $317,000. Sure. But I will tell you, the point we're making is that probably if you do live in a higher cost of living city, mm-hmm. that more of your monthly income is going towards your shelter.
Sure.
And that actually has an impact, a large impact on your financial life. And yep. that's why we want to go a little deeper and kind of compare. If we know that the average American is spending five times their income, but we feel that three times is more appropriate, what is that difference doing to your long-term financial self?
So again, let's kind of just walk through this case study. So we know that at five times the median household income, that's a home price of about $318,000. If you were going to do three times, we're going to call that the affordable home, that'd be about $190,000. Well, we're going to put 20% down. You know, that's kind of rule of thumb. We want to get out of PMI. So the mortgage that you're going to have on your expensive home is going to be about $254,000. The mortgage that you would have on the affordable home is going to be just under about $152,000. Well, when you run that through, you're looking at a monthly payment of either $1,200 a month for the expensive home or a little over $700 a month for the affordable home. And if you just calculate the difference, that's about $490 a month.
Now, wait a minute. Pause, because we know there's a lot more going on than just $500 a month. Mm-hmm. Because the bigger your house is, the nicer it is. Property taxes are more. Mm-hmm. Your insurance on the house is yep. more. Probably it's bigger, so it's going to have more furniture yep. cost. I'm going to go ahead and tell you, they've made it premium comes in. The bigger your house is, when you have people show up to do service, mm-hmm. you know, landscaping or other things, if your house is nice, they charge you more
yep.
to clean the windows, other things. So we didn't put any of that in there. So that's not built into our analysis. We did the bare bones conservative approach to this to keep the numbers reasonable. Mm-hmm. We just took the difference in the monthly payments only on the principal and interest of the mortgage.
That's exactly right. So if we think about that $490 a month saving, what if instead of buying the more expensive home, you bought the affordable home and you saved that $490 per month? Well, what ends up happening, and again, we assumed a 30-year-old, so we're using a 9% rate of return here. Over that 30-year mortgage period, you will have saved $176,400. But because you are investing that, by the time you get to age 65, it will be worth over $1.4 million.
So you can tell, guys, this is huge. This is a seven-figure decision that a lot of people walk into because when you build a house or buy a house, it's so easy to focus on the payment and say, well, gosh, I really would like to have this feature. I'd really like to have this. And I can afford it because it's only $150 mm-hmm. more a month for this feature. It's only $150 more a month because especially when you're building a house, your builder will tell you, I can do anything for a price.
That's right.
And then when you think about you can amortize it over 30 years, even expensive stuff seems affordable on a monthly basis.
Yep.
But remember, you're not investing in yourself or in your future. You're paying down debt mm-hmm. for every additional upgrade that maybe you didn't need
yep.
or maybe it was a stretch bigger than what you can afford. All these things have a long-term impact, and $1.5 million is nothing to sneeze at when you're talking about your financial independence.
And so if you're someone out there listening in iTunes world, iHeartRadio, Stitcher, and you're not actually watching this on YouTube, one of the things that we do on YouTube and Facebook is we live stream this. And Brian, you've already alluded to this. We have so many folks in the comments talking about high cost of living areas, and those home prices don't make sense. Here's what I would have you step back and think about. No matter what homes cost in your area, no matter yeah. where that is, if you're looking at two different mortgage payments and the difference in those mortgage payments is $500 a month, this mathematics applies. So whether yeah. it's looking at a $2,500 mortgage versus a $3,000 mortgage, this math applies when it comes to making your housing decision.
Yeah. So I want to pivot now because we know housing's big. We know cars are big. We know credit card debt when you're starting out. And I focus on the starting out element. But guys, this is the part, and I talked about this in pre-show, and I think it's worth kind of discussing it, is that we have very successful clients that come in, and one of the things they're trying to figure out is how do they create an estate plan so that if they pass away, their 17-year-old or 18-year-old child doesn't squander the $3 to $4 million inheritance. That discussion, we spend thousands of dollars with estate attorneys creating a great estate plan. So you're like, wait a minute, this isn't an estate. No, I want to talk to you about, because this hit me hard when we were doing pre-show planning, cost of education.
Yep.
Because we are asking, if you want to talk about college, we're asking 17-year-old and 18-year-old children to make decisions that will impact their entire financial life, especially if they're using debt and leverage. And here's where this is can get very slippery. Education, I want everybody to know, we have created the Abundance Cycle is, the Money Guy Show is I'm holding the ladder of opportunity for you to come learn, apply, and grow, and create success for yourself. Because that's what education did it for you, it did it for me.
Absolutely.
I consider education the ladder out of any crappy situation that you might be in your personal life. So it breaks my heart that when you apply that knowledge that education is your ladder, and we're even holding it for you so you can learn these financial concepts, it can be turned into a negative force.
Absolutely.
Because a lot of people, and we're seeing the fruits of this, I think some of the unrest that we're experiencing right now is that a lot of young people are kind of ticked off because they spent a lot of money on education and they're just not getting the fruits from because maybe, you know, they didn't have somebody whispering in their ear these big discussions. So I want to talk about that. And why am I talking about a millionaire who's worried about passing down money to their 17 and 18-year-old child? You will see what I mean by this, because this hit me hard when we went through it. So let's talk about this.
So again, one of the things that we've talked about is we are proponents for education. But now that we've sat on this side and we've hired folks from all over the country, from all different educational institutions, one of the things that we always counsel parents to have a conversation with their teenage 17, 18-year-old students is, the choice of the school that you make matters, and it's not always because of the name. Because I think that's common knowledge. I want to go to the most prestigious, the highest end, the top level school. What we found is that when it comes to personal finance, perhaps that isn't always the best decision to make.
Yeah, without a doubt, your major as well as where you go to college is going to be important. Now, look, I'm going to start this because I saw this quote. I loved it. I've thought about this because, but go ahead and pull the quote up because I'll read it and then tell you a little tweak that we wish we'd had a full-time equivalent Daniel do. This is T. Boone Pickens, and he passed away not too long ago. We've actually done some content on him because he wrote a letter of all the things he kind of learned and wanted to pay it forward with as he knew he was dying.
Sure.
So, but here's a quote that I thought was interesting so you can see how T. Boone Pickens thinks because he was a billionaire. The guys who graduate from Harvard usually wind up working for the guys who graduated from Oklahoma State. By the way, that's where Mr. Pickens went to. So if I had to do this, I would scratch through Oklahoma State and write UGA
University of Georgia, baby.
Right underneath that because I do think there is something about it. And look, I don't want you to just take our word for it. We do an annual wealth study, and I've seen other people, I think the Ramsey Solutions does their own wealth study, and their numbers are somewhat similar. That's why I love when you actually research what are successful people doing in their own lives. This is what we found from doing our own wealth study, is that do millionaires go to private college? And this is what we found. For college, you can see only 36% of our millionaire clients went to private school, 59% went to public universities, and then 5% either went to both or they didn't even go to college.
Both meaning perhaps they did like public undergrad and then private graduate school or something like that.
But there's something to the fact that close to 60% of millionaires, at least in our own research, and I've seen this, like I said, with Ramsey Solutions, went to public universities. Yep. It ties into what T. Boone Pickens was sharing. So, but we wanted to go a little deeper because listen to these drastic differences in numbers. If you want to know what a private, nonprofit, four-year university costs per year, it's right under $50,000.
So you can do the math really easy and say private university, four-year degree, that's $200,000 to go to a private university.
So compare that to a public university, which is right under $22,000 right now. That's a big difference. If you're comparing 49, close to 50,000 to 22,000, mm-hmm. there's a lot of meat on that bone yep. for building for yourself. And like I said, 17 and 18 year olds are making this decision. So let's put some numbers to it and let them know, what is this decision you're actually making cost you?
So again, let's walk through two students. And again, this is full-time equivalent Daniel, who's coming up with these names, which I love it. It's private school Peter and public school Paula. So private school Peter could go to public school for free, but he chooses instead to go to a private institution.
Yeah, this is a smart guy. Could have gotten a full ride. Yep. Sounds like scholarships, but you know, he won the prestige of that private university. That's right. Was a song that he just couldn't avoid.
So Paula, she decides she's going to go to a public college for free. She's going to use scholarships and aid to do that. So Peter, in order to pay for the private school, he's going to take out loans to pay the difference. And we just told you that the difference in total tuition costs is going to be a hair under $112,000.
About 28 grand a year.
About 28 grand a year. Paula is going to graduate debt-free from college. No student loans, nothing to do, nothing to pay back after she graduates. So if Peter's loans are at 5% interest, he's going to pay $737 per month for 20 years to pay off his loans. That's what it's going to take to pay off that $112,000. Well, Paula doesn't have any loans, but again, we want to compare apples to apples. So let's say that after she graduates, she just saves $737 per month for retirement, but she only does that for the 20 years. So we're going to compare apples to apples. Peter's paying off student loan debt. Paula's going to take that savings and invest the difference. Tracking with me?
By the way, $737 a month for a young person is a tremendous. I can go ahead and tell you, compounding interest-wise, deferred gratification, this is going to definitely be a great big beautiful tomorrow. So go ahead and continue on with the analysis.
So Paula saves $737 per month for 20 years. And again, she's in her 20s, so we're going to assume a 10% rate of return here. After 20 years, she will have saved almost $177,000. But if she lets that money continue to grow all the way until retirement, that money will grow to be over $5.5 million.
So I want to come back to my original discussion. We have millionaire clients that are creating estate plans that cost a few thousand dollars to develop with mm-hmm. estate attorneys to make sure that their 17 and 18-year-old children don't get the $2 to $3 million too early because they're worried they're going to blow it. But yet we're letting 17 and 18-year-old kids make decisions that cost them $5.6 million in the future. Guys, this is a big deal. Mm-hmm. This is huge. This is the reason we put this at the end, is because this is happening every day that we have young people. And unfortunately, that ladder of opportunity that we're trying to hold for them for education is being put upside down by straddling them with debt. And then there's a bitterness that I think comes
Absolutely.
From this, and it breaks my heart. So I'm just telling you, use this as a PSA. Pay attention to what your major is in college. Pay attention to where you go to school. And remember, if you're trying to have some type of guideline for how much student loan debt you should have by the time you graduate, I want you to think about what you can earn in your first year mm-hmm. out of college. Try to keep the student loan debt below that. Now, I can hear every doctor out there or who's working in their middle of their residence right now is like, I can't do that. Sure. You know, to be a medical student, I get it. You're an asterisk. We'll give you an exception. But still, focus on the opportunity cost, because there's a reason that we have millionaire clients spending thousands of dollars to save their children from themselves, but yet we have an entire group of people that are straddling themselves with this zombie debt mm-hmm. for the rest of their life. And then they wonder, how do I get out of this? Yep. That's unfortunate to turn something so positive into a negative. I want to transition now to, what does all this mean for your life in general if you start stacking these savings opportunities on top of each other?
So again, let's just kind of walk through these four areas that I think all of us either have been faced with or will be faced with in our lifetime. We showed you that just a small credit card balance of $6,000 by retirement could cost you $574,000. By opting to buy a more expensive car than a more affordable car, that could cost you almost $400,000 in retirement dollars.
And remember, by the way, no change in what your monthly payment sure. was. It's just that's the car salesman saying, hey, don't pay that car off in 3 years. Let's pay it off in 7 yep. years, because that's what all your buddies and friends are doing. You should do the same. No, it's costing you $400,000. Pay attention.
How about the decision, instead of buying a house that is 3 times my annual income, I buy a house that's 5 times my annual income. Well, that could potentially cost almost $1.5 million in retirement assets. And then the big one is if I start my working career, if I enter into the workforce saddled with student loan debt that perhaps is going to take me 20 years to get out from under, that could cost me $5.6 million in retirement assets. If you add just these four decisions up, this is huge. This is gigantic. This is a life-changing sum of money.
Yeah, this is, I often see the stat of how many people can't come up with $1,000. Mm-hmm. It's about 60% of the U.S. population yep. can't come up with $1,000. When you start seeing the decisions and all the traps that are set financially, you know, it's almost like Wile E. Coyote, you know, he's out there setting them up. He's mm-hmm. putting pine straw. But instead of the Roadrunner making it through it unscathed, we're falling into every one of them. Yep. We're getting bruised. We're getting bloodied. And our financial life is bearing the price. And then we wonder, why did financial success pass me by? Where's the missed opportunity? Go read our comments section when we do the 20, 30, 40 by age series. You'll see without a doubt a 40, a 50, or 60 year old saying, I wish I'd seen this when I was 20 years old. If I would have seen this when I was 20 or 30 years old, I'd be in a better place. And then for all you naysayers, the trolls that come out of the bridges and say, no, you can't do this. This doesn't work. Go look at those comments of the people who've walked in the shoes. They've had the experience, and that experience has bred to turned into wisdom. Mm-hmm. And now they're wondering, what could I have done differently? Learn from that. You do not have to make mistakes. You can actually have that wisdom by learning from others. And that's why we have the Money Guy Show. That's why we have the Abundance Cycle. You can make these decisions. So hopefully, instead of saying total cost, this is total money saved and earned it. So that you can turn your life. It just completely create an opportunity for yourself. And that's what we talk about. We don't come from money.
Nope.
But I tell you what, the more we've learned from education of working with successful people, managing our own money, managing money for successful people for decades, this stuff works. Change your mindset, be a financial mutant, and you will be rewarded in the long term with a great financial independence and lifestyle.
If you love the stuff that we're sharing with you, and I even saw one of the comments on here just said, hey, yeah, you know, they did the show, I think they did the show, and I used that, and I went and refinanced, and I bet he went and grabbed the resource off of our resource page. We're going to keep loading you guys up with information, because the whole thing that we wanted you to take away from this episode is that the decisions we make now, early on in life, and early on in life being today versus the future, whether you're 20 years old or whether you're 60 years old, the decisions we make today can have an impact on our financial future. We want to equip you as much as we can to make really sound financial decisions. So one of the things that we do is we do this show, we put it out there for you, but we also put resources out on our website. Go to our website, moneyguy.com/resources. We have templates, PDFs, spreadsheets, ebooks, things for you to take and use to help take your finances to the next level.
Big decision. I mean, little decisions lead to big outcomes. Right. So take a little bit of today so you have that big, 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 great, big, beautiful tomorrow. I mean, guys, this is the Abundance Cycle. We kind of love on you, learn, apply, and grow. You're going to reach a level of success that you're going to need some help. You're going to remember who planted the seeds. That's why we work with clients in 41 states.
Yep.
So go check it out. MoneyGuy.com, AboundWealth.com. We're going to keep creating content, continue to be passionate about this, and we're going to continue to make you successful. I'm Brian. This is Bo. Money Guy team out.